Welcome to episode 106 of I Thought I Knew How, a podcast about knitting and life and all sorts. I'm your host, Anne Frost, and this episode was recorded on July 14th, 2023. It's Bastille Day as I record, and I suppose that is fitting, as this episode is going to be a bit of a fiber log slash travel log of my recent trip to Normandy. I have some on-the-spot recordings to share from a few of the places, and a report of a surprise fiber destination we found while we were there, as well as a yarn review. Let us begin. So why Normandy? My husband and I tend to spend our anniversaries in one of two ways. We are either on other sides of the planet from one another, or we head off together somewhere. The last few years, we have been in the habit of traveling together. This year, we had the initial thought to travel to Japan. We love Japan. We first went when we were living in Southeast Asia, and after our first visit, we went three more times in 2 years. But my husband pointed out that with the other travel I have coming up this year, visiting a place that would take nearly 24 hours to get to and would require completely inverting our clock was probably not the best idea, so scrapped that plan and looked toward Europe instead. Paris came up as an option, but we've both been twice, and the last time we went as a couple, we did all the things. It was a great trip at the time. I loved it, but I also felt like we had done everything we needed to do there, and that going back to do it again would lack the specialness of the first time. I don't remember who suggested a road trip through Normandy, but whichever of us did, we went with it. The more I looked into it, the more I fell in love with the idea, and I planned 8 days for us there, moving from one location to the next every day or two and catching the must-see spots like Rouen, where much of Joan of Arc's story took place, and Mont-Saint-Michel, where I have a family connection, so I'm slightly obsessed with it, plus the Bayeux Tapestry and Le Mans, and a chance to see Versailles again because the first time we went to Paris together, it was winter and everything in the garden was covered. Anyway, this trip, it was going to be most excellent. And initially, I had planned for this to be a yarn and fiber-free trip. But one thing we didn't think of when we planned our wedding for July 6th, all those years ago, was that while we were picking a day that would make it easy for our families to have time off for our destination wedding, it would mean that for the rest of our lives, traveling for our anniversary would mean traveling with a bajillion other Americans who were also taking advantage of the long holiday weekend. So, as we planned, my husband realized that if we left a day earlier and came home a day later than we initially planned, the overall cost of the trip would drop by a sizable amount. With 2 extra days to play with, I decided it would be okay to look for something fiber-related to add to the itinerary, and I asked for recommendations online. That led me to a handful of fiber producers there in Normandy who were all going to be at a fiber festival the first full day we were there, called La Fil de Manche, just an hour or so from where we'd be staying. The stars aligned, added it to the itinerary, and when we got there, off we went. My husband even tagged along. The event was on the grounds of an old manor house that had been partially modernized in appearance. We drove through beautiful farmland to get there, including fields of flax and verges thick with wildflowers. Normandy had the bonus feature of being the place where flax is still grown, and we saw it in several different stages as we went along. There was itty-bitty spitty rain at times, but then the sun would come out and shine again. It was a lovely half day out in the country, and it gave me the opportunity to see dozens of members of the fiber community all in one spot. I do have some audio from the event recorded straight to my iPhone without the help of an external microphone, which I did not have with me on the trip. I didn't actually interview anyone while I was there because the sales actually were, people were doing pretty well as far as shopping. Everyone was busy and I didn't want to interrupt sales. So it's just sort of a description of the event. Enjoy. I will find you on the other side. Hello, everybody. I am at Le Fil de la Manche, which is a little yarn festival slash gathering
about an hour outside of Rouen, where we are staying on this visit to France. Magically, this yarn festival just happened to be happening on the second day that we were in France. This is only the second day. I have not warmed up to my French at all. I do not have much French to begin with. And luckily, it has not been a problem here. People have either very kindly switched to English for me, or we have made it work. It's not hard to work out a financial transaction in another language. You can sort of point and hold up your fingers to how many you want. And yeah, if you know your numbers, you're going to be okay. So yesterday was an absolutely gorgeous day. The day that we arrived, we ended up going to the house and gardens of Claude Monet. Absolutely stunningly beautiful, blue skies, warm. The flowers were in full bloom. There were several groups there from cruise ships. They would have been cruise ships from the river, and we did see a small cruise ship as we were passing over the river later, and sort of traveling in little herds through the gardens. And it was fine. Even with the large groups that were there, there were places in the garden where you could feel like you were alone and just take in the quiet and the beauty and see why Monet was so inspired by his surroundings. Even inside the house, there were fiber crafts to be seen. There was a beautiful crochet counterpane on one of the beds that, of course, was hand done. All crochet is hand done. And down the road, there is a museum to Impressionism, and they had a wonderful exhibit about children in Impressionist paintings. And there was this great photo of a girl on the swings, just absolute joy, swinging so hard. She was holding on to the chains of the swing and just, you know, totally upside down, smiling, laughing, and wearing a Fair Isle yoke sweater. So fiber crafts everywhere. But today, as I said, I came here to this fiber festival. So it's on the grounds of an old country manor house that's been updated into an event space. There's two levels to the event. When you first park and walk through, there's a large lawn area that had maybe a dozen booths going up each side. And you can pass through that, go up a little hill. There were two more booths just at the top of the hill. And then maybe another dozen or so larger booths in sort of an open courtyard area between the church and the building itself. And then inside the building, there's an older area that's been updated with modern large glass windows from floor to ceiling. And they have like four vendors inside as well. It's so lovely in this little courtyard area. There's two rows of three large established trees each. And in the middle of it, there's a long fountain with a standing carved pediment sort of thing at one end and forming a reflecting, got a truck going by, live recording on site, for it with a reflecting pool. And on the one side of that, they have couches and easy chairs and things set up that are just full of husbands. And then on the other side, there's a table with some chairs and things, and some knitters are starting to sort of set up and get to know one another. There's a big hammock that no one's been brave enough to sit in yet. We had to move because a supplier came and pulled up for the food vending area. We have a bit more wind and bird song where we are now. So where I'm standing at the top of where you come up the hill, and just over, sort of over the edge, there's a walled area, and over the edge is a pond with trees on the other side. So we're going to have some bird noises. As we are driving here, we were in the country. We were in super country, lots and lots of wheat fields and linen fields and cows. In fact, at one point I was like, I'm not even sure that that's linen. I've never actually seen linen in nature before. I've seen it dried and I've seen it processed, but I've never seen it in nature. And so did a little Googling and confirmed it was linen. So very, very thin stalks, maybe 18 inches to 2 feet tall. And at the top, there's round balls that are the seed pods. And the fields around here are very large, which makes me wonder if they're being grown for linseed oil and linseeds as opposed to for linen. Because my understanding is that linen still needs to be processed by hand or harvested by hand. And they just seem like really massive fields. Of course, there is still a large demand for linen, and so they may well be harvested by hand. I just don't know. I don't have enough experience with it. What I do know about linen, for the most part, came to me from issue 3 of the Journal of Scottish Yarns, which is all about linen. Fascinating articles and good preparation for coming on this trip. So as we came in, there was a ticket booth for us. It was very easy. They took my bad French very well, but I also did hear them speaking English amongst each other as they were doing some of the ticketing. So you could have gotten in very easily without French. So it's just €5, okay? €5 to get in. And with that, you got a pin for the event and a very nice cotton tote bag with the symbol of the festival on it. We came in, there were some wet felters selling some bags and wall hangings and things. There was one person I saw who had sewn bags and organizers. There were a few people who had really cute stitch markers and containers for the stitch markers. And other than that, this is a yarn festival. There are tons of people selling their yarn here. There was one person who had a great deal of hand-spun yarn. There was someone who had a bit of fiber, but everything else here is dyed yarn. And there's quite a variety available. For the most part, it is wool, overwhelmingly wool, which I thought was interesting because this is such a linen-heavy area. There's a ton of fingering weight, of course, but there's also dealers here who are selling wool of various thicknesses and various spin types. It's very common for the breed information to be on the label, which I totally appreciated. And that's not really that different between English and French. Even if the word is a little different, it's easy enough to figure it out. It's close enough to English that you can tell what breed it is. A lot of the dyers are selling like unicorn tails, I like to think of them, like the 20 to 30 gram balls as a group. And I ended up picking up one from actually a German seller that has her sock yarn. She was labeling it as non-nylon sock yarn. And her shop is called Ovis, it's Ovis, etc. And I noticed her card machine information came up in German. I think she's one of the German dealers that was here. And she sells sustainable hand-dyed yarn. So I got a collection of 4 minis in green, purple, red, and blue. Really richly dyed ones. And I got a sort of gold shade in the main size to use as the main color. And I figure I can find a shawl pattern that will allow for that. And then in addition to that, different seller up the hill called Pôle, Laines. They had really beautiful, again, richly colored sort of I think of the deeper jewel tones. I almost think of as neutrals. They had that I guess tells you what I think about color these days. But they had a really deep, deep purple, 100% merino with sort of that tonal dyeing, sort of a brownish purple called Le Célibataire. I got 2 of those and then 2 coordinating hanks of 72% mohair, 28% silk fuzzy blend that I'm thinking of doing a Robach shawl out of. I hope I got enough. I don't have that pattern is in issue 3 of the journal and I don't have it on my phone. I have it on my iPad that's in the car, so I made my best guess. But now I need to go look for some linen. That was my goal in coming here, and I've bought wool and mohair. So I'm going to do another pass through of the event space and keep my eye out for some linen. Wish me luck. I will say, just like in the U.S., with these the yarn sellers here, you see a lot of samples of the yarn knit up as Stephen West sweaters. You also see a lot of Andrea Mowry patterns in the samples. Some things are just universal. What can I say? I haven't seen any linen yet, but I have seen a lot of cotton dealers. Well, not a lot. There's been a few cotton dealers, which is also nice to see. As far as the weather today, we are alternating between little bitty spitty rains and beautiful blue sunshine. And right now, itty bitty spitty rain. But that's okay. It's not phasing anyone. Everybody is happy to be here. I will say the mood is very similar to the mood of a festival you will find at home. There's lots of people here who came in carloads of twos and threes and fives, as well as folks like me who are making our way through on our own. But everybody is happy to be here. Sorry, I got distracted by some incredibly glowing dyed silk that I am going to resist. I am going to resist. I tell you, this would be a very dangerous place for me if I was not having to get it all home in my suitcase. I did plan specifically for that. These are the sort of games I play with myself. So I packed my toiletries that were nearly finished. And then I brought a full replacement in case I used them up, because I was like, hey, you know, it's holding space for me. And on the way back, all of that almost empty stuff will be gone. I'd be able to fit more yarn. I was very conscientious about that. I left about a quarter. I didn't expand my bag as I left, as I packed. And I made sure that, you know, everything was sort of loosely fitting in it. And I was very, very proud of myself. Until I got to our hotel the first night and realized I didn't pack any pajamas at all. I did borrow a t-shirt and we're going to look for some pajamas. But yeah, needless to say, there's plenty of room for yarn to go home, but I do want to try and control myself. So I did just do a circuit of the upper area of the festival now. I didn't see any linen among any of the dealers, so I'm going to go ahead and make my way back down to the first area again. I do know I did see one seller there who had some, but it looked like it was actually a worsted weight or maybe a DK weight linen, which is pretty rare. And I don't know how I feel about knitting with that, so I'm going to go down and put my hands on it, I think. It's doing more than just spitting now. I found myself a climbing vine to stand under a little bit while I record, but it's a heavy spit at this point. Literally no one seems to care. Everyone's just sort of tucked themselves in underneath the coverings of the booths and are continuing to shop and chat. It's lovely. But yeah, I think I may have misrepresented earlier how many booths there are down on this bottom. There's probably 12 to 15. Is that what I said before? And then I would say there's maybe two dozen total up on the upper level of the festival. So it is starting to truly rain. I am going to get under a proper booth and wait it out. I'm actually pretty dry right here, so maybe I'll be okay for another minute or two. I think I see the linen booth over to the side, actually, so I'll make a run for it. There seems to... Oh, we have a little break in the rain. Okay, I'm going to cross over and see if I remembered correctly that they're the linen seller. They were not. Now I'm just walking in the rain. Where were they? Oh, I see them. I see them. Okay, I'm going to be okay.
It's raining so hard.
Success. I was able to get 95% linen, 5% cotton blend, which I think is going to be as good as I get. You know, I did my research ahead of time and there were several sellers that had 100% linen on their website, but I think that the touch factor can be an issue for some linen dealers it's not washed linen, then it can feel very rough and fibrous in the skein. And I wonder if people brought their blends instead, because it is a touchy-touchy, feely-feely event. I am really happy with what I got, though. It is a size 3 yarn, which, that's a worsted, right? I'm remembering that right? They only had the pattern available in French. So I took a picture. She said it was available in English on Ravelry, so I'll download that later. But it's a very square styled sweater, just short sleeve, and really the sleeve is just the edge of the jumper that sort of bends over your arm, and you put a little edging on it. It has a little sort of, it's plain stitching all over with a section of garter just at the underneath the neckline. So a very simple summer knit, and I think I'm going to look forward to getting that on my needles. The rain seems to have stopped. I'm going to step outside. We had a moment where I was just at the edge of the booth, and the top had filled up enough that it just started pouring down my back. And so I gave out a little, oh, and jumped inside. And then the seller was just mortified and came out to the front of the table underneath the tent still and push up on the underside of the tent to let more water off, at which point it went directly into my bag, which was still sort of hanging out underneath the tent. So I'm well and truly damp at this point, but we're gonna call this a successful festival. I've got things for 3 projects, and I'm going to start making my way to the car, which I think is where my husband ended up. It has been delightful. I think my time between the rain is over. It is coming back again. So I'm going to make my way back to the car. And this lovely day out in the countryside of France is going to come to an end.
Le Fil de Manche happens yearly. If you'll be in Paris or Normandy while it's happening early in July, it would be a lovely day out. If you're in Paris, you can go back through Giverny and visit Monet's home and garden, which is just stunning that time of year. I have cast on some of the yarn that I got there. One of the vendors was Pôle. She had one of her tables covered with pairings of a hank of mohair silk blend and a hank of 100% merino fingering weight right next to each other, dyed the same color, just a whole plethora of these pairings. Those of you who have picked up issue 3 of the Journal of Scottish Yarns have probably seen the Robach shawl, which calls for a hank of mohair and a hank of fingering weight. In fact, last episode, I spoke with Allison Main and Ronnie, the wool chemist, who collaborated on that project. So I saw the display, and all I could think was, aw, look at all those baby Robach shawls. My hands went to a color called Un Petit Chat Sauvage, or a little wild cat. It's a deep mauve, leaning towards purple in some lights and towards brown in others. The mohair has a very consistent color to it, but the shine of the silk makes the color still feel alive. The merino is a superwash single, and it took the dye more tonally. So there are areas that aren't as dark as others, and it has the effect of imitating the shine of the silk in the mohair hank, while actually being more of a sheen than a shine, I would say. However, the silk in the mohair gives a slightly silvery sheen to the yarn, while the tonal parts of the merino give it a slightly golden sheen. Now that I'm home, I have it wound into balls and have cast on the Robach shawl just to have something to knit while I'm working on other crochet projects for the make-along. The merino areas of the shawl are garter stitch, and every other row of the lace is purling, so it's not a totally mindless knit, but there are long areas where I don't have to give it my full attention. I like both of the yarns. They both definitely pass the softness test. As we mentioned in the last episode, mohair has come a long way, and Pôle is using the good stuff. The color I chose is quite dark, and I'm afraid I am to the point where dark yarn is starting to pose a challenge. It's not helping that I'm knitting it on a mid-brown shade of wooden needles. Unfortunately, I do not have metal needles with a sharp enough tip to handle the mohair, so I'm having to knit with this wooden set, and there's not much color contrast between the needles and the yarn. I may have to go pick up another pair of needles. Or I could just sit in better lighting. Anyway, all of that is commentary about me, not about the yarn. I love the color. I love the tonality. I'm not having any issues with splitting, so I can happily endorse the work of Pôle Laine. If you come across some, give it a try with confidence, and I will have a link for you in the show notes if you'd like to order. For now, let's have a little song. This is Invisible Love by Wild Heart, paired with Kaii Dreams. Enjoy, and I will see you on the other side with our next stop on the trip.
Ain't no way you just call me now, standing outside in the rain. It happened again. This ain't the same. But you and I know this ain't never gonna change. Oh, no way. Yeah. All I want is a feeling up there.
No, 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 no.
Oh, I may be blind, but it's you that can't see.
Oh,
I think you should know. Love's not into the cold. No, this ain't what it's supposed to look like. Unless it is invisible, invisible.
Of travel, we found ourselves in Bayeux on the last day of their yearly medieval festival. We got there just a few hours before things ended on that last day, but this was not like the Ren Fair experience we get on this side of the pond, where the organizers will book a fairground or even have a space dedicated to just their yearly event. This festival was happening in the center of town, around the cathedral and along several of the streets. And while not everyone was dressed up for the occasion, those who were doing it well. There was nothing cartoony or high fantasy about most of the folks in costume, which makes a sort of sense, I suppose. I did see a couple of girls wearing elf ears, but other than that, people seemed to be celebrating the area's actual medieval history rather than a Tolkien-esque version of it. So that was all fun to see. The following day, we made a visit to the tapestry. I can't say that I went into it thinking this was going to be an earth-shaking experience for me. I've known about the Bayeux Tapestry since I was maybe in my teens, but it's not like it's something I had a great longing to see. I'm not an embroiderer. You know, I had an interest. I wanted to see it while we were there, but it wasn't a bucket list sight for me. You arrive and you pay for your ticket and you're handed like a wand with a speaker at one end that automatically begins playing when you step into the dark room where the tapestry is displayed. It's something like 230 feet long. So you can see the tapestry extend away into the dark and then sort of turn a corner. It's been mounted on a larger fabric panel behind glass with large Roman numerals written on the mounting cloth. And the audio on the wand starts and it does not stop. It describes what's happening on the tapestry and what you should be paying attention to, but the audio moves you along the length of the tapestry and you finish and the audio stops and you're done. After the first minute of listening and moving along, I was already frustrated because the embroidery work was so interesting and I wanted more time. The audio picks up some things for you, but it doesn't comment on others, like the fact that as the panels start in France, the borders, the top and bottom borders, are all like Edenic with fruits and animals lying down together in peace. And then it crosses over to England where the borders then are full of hunters and dogs taking down prey. And so it's like, well, where's the commentary there? I stopped trying to pause the audio and just went along with the pack, getting the whole story overview. And then my husband, bless him, had a seat and did some work on his phone while I went back to the start and worked my way along again, this time without an audio, just paying attention to the tapestry and the techniques the creators use, both embroidery techniques and visual storytelling techniques, like leaving areas blank to add depth and an additional color without actually having to stitch something, and forced perspective, and the placement of buildings that extended into the borders and what that said about those buildings. So the entire tapestry is bordered at the top and bottom, but certain things extend into that top border. When William's army is at sea, for instance, the top border disappears entirely to make room for the masts of the ship and this huge event that's happening. And during the actual battle, the lower border is given over. Instead of being, you know, mythical beasts and things like that, it becomes the bodies of the fallen, which creates the look of a battlefield, the surface of a battlefield. The design choices of its creators, names all lost to time at this point, were just brilliant. The Bayeux Museum has a scanned version you can click through. I will put a link in the show notes, but if you can, if you possibly can, make it a bucket list item to go see. Go see it in person. It was absolutely brilliant. There are a few more sheepy and fibery stops to come, but before we get to those, let's have another musical interlude. Enjoy this instrumental from Humans Win. It's called Summer in Paris. Back in a moment. Thank you. skipping a lot of stops and visits to things as I go. I do want to keep this to just fiber-related things. The last few fibery things I have to talk about are really more sheep-related, though. After Bayeux, we moved on to visit Mont-Saint-Michel. If that sounds familiar, but you're not quite placing it in your mind as you listen, Mont-Saint-Michel is a small island off the coast of Normandy with a large abbey at the top dedicated to St. Michael, surrounded by a bay that empties out completely at low tide, allowing visitors to cross on foot if they wish. There is a road that you can walk over or you can take a bus over that gets you to the base of the island, and then you can walk up one side on this road, which kicks back on itself to the entrance of the abbey. And that's it. There's buildings along that road. There's the abbey on the top. The entire thing, if you were to just sort of sketch out the shape of it, it comes, it's like a cone, just comes right up to the point where St. Michael stands on the top of the abbey. In the salt marshes in that area, there's a breed of sheep called the Pré-Salé sheep. The animals eat grasses that are high in salt and iodine, so their meat is considered a local delicacy. Pré-Salé, of course, pre-salted. How's that for a name for your sheep? We did try some in a restaurant on Mont-Saint-Michel, and perhaps I don't have a highly attuned palate, but to me it just tasted a bit gaming. The area is the only place that is allowed to mark their lamb as AOC or Agneau Pré-Salé, like champagne is the only place allowed to call their product champagne. So the gift shops on Mont-Saint-Michel had a lot of sheep-themed items from goofy, cartoony t-shirts to home decor, but there was no actual wool or yarn in sight, and Google got me nowhere as far as finding out how or even whether their wool is processed and used. The animals themselves are lovely creatures. They have dark legs and faces with a white fleece that leans toward a pale gold. The road leading up to the abbey from the base of the island is not terribly long, and it's nearly all restaurants and gift shops. There are a handful of small museums that were not well reviewed online, so we just skipped those. The one place you could poke your head into along the way up that wasn't food or shopping related was a small church dedicated to St. Michael. I can't remember exactly, but I would say there were maybe a dozen pews in front of a small chapel where two priests were in the middle of a mass in French. There were a few very small side chapels on the other side of the building from the door, and some of the tourists were drifting in and out despite the service going on. I wasn't sure of the protocol, so I stood at the door for a bit, reluctant to go in with the mass going on. But I thought they got to a stopping point. I thought they'd finished. So I went in only to discover that they were just sort of like the two priests were like shifting positions. So I took a seat and sat through the rest of the service. I'm not Catholic. I've only been to two masses in my entire life, and it was not in my first language. So I did not know what all was happening with the service. But at one point, the priest began to sing and the acoustics were unreal. I had my phone in hand, so I turned it on to record a snippet. Mont-Saint-Michel was a lovely experience, despite the crowd of fellow tourists, and we actually got to visit twice because I'd left my knitting bag in the restaurant and we had to go back for it. We'd walked over and back on the bridge the first time, but we took the bus over the second time. But then the lines were so long for the returning bus because it was getting towards the end of the day that we just walked back again. We got our steps in that day. I have one last stop to tell you about that we found a few days later, but let's have a song before we hear about that. I know some of you miss the music when I do interview episodes, so I'm trying to make it up to you in this one. This is Jon Presstone with Casa de Frio.
Casa de Frio.
Right. To this point of the trip, every one of the fiber and sheep experiences had been planned ahead of time. I had my sights firmly set on the non-yarny for the rest of the time we were there. We were going to visit Le Mans and Chartres and Versailles and had a few days planned at Disneyland Paris for my inner 11-year-old, and that was all going to be well and good. We were driving from Chartres to Versailles, and a sign caught my eye along the highway. So different parts of the world have different ways of advertising local attractions. Around here, they are usually blue signs with a white print. In the UK, they are brown with white print and an arrow pointing off in the proper direction. In France, and I think also in Austria and Spain, so it might be like a EU thing, they are big signs, maybe 5 or 6 feet square, with the name of the attraction at the top and an image of the actual attraction on the sign in shades of brown. So the whole sign is just different shades of brown showing what the attraction is with the name at the top. And if it's a sign for an area that has lots of attraction, the image will be sort of collage type with all of the attractions fitted into this to the image. So as we were driving, I looked up and saw one of these brown image tourist signs with Rambouillet across the top and a large image of a chateau, and down in the corner was a ram's head. At which point I yelled, "This is where Rambouillet sheep came from!" So, dear husband, who was driving, changed our destination to Rambouillet while I got on Google to see what the actual destination point should be for whatever site was symbolized by the ram's head. By the late 1700s, France was importing 30 million francs of merino wool from Spain, which for hundreds of years had been protecting the merino breed, not allowing any out of the country under pain of death, because their wool was so sought after that it was a main source of income for the country. Some had made it out here and there, but nothing on any large scale and nothing on any lasting scale. However, in the mid-1700s, Charles III of Spain began sending flocks to some of his royal cousins, including a flock of 366 that were sent to Louis XVI of France. The flock were taken to the royal sheepfold, or the Bergerie Royale, where they were crossed with English long wool sheep. The resulting Rambouillet merinos are larger than Spanish merinos with longer staple lengths. The wool has less sheen than a merino, but it has retained its fineness and can easily be worn next to the skin. At the time of the French Revolution, the location was named the Bergerie Nationale, or the National Sheepfold, which is what it continues to be called today. And that is where we headed as we left the highway. Unfortunately, Google also informed me that the sheepfold was closed that day, but it had a cafe that was open. So we decided to carry on and see what we could see. We arrived to a bustle of activity. While the sheepfold was in fact closed to the public, it was open to a number of school groups and there were children everywhere. The sheepfold was not what I expected. Coming from New England, I was thinking there might be a series of wooden barns to provide some shelter for the animals as needed. No. Rambouillet sheep were big business and the buildings reflected it. There was a manor-style house for the main shepherd and a series of barns that fit right in with the architecture of the main house. There was a large arch that used to serve as the entry of the area with text at the top commemorating the arrival of the Spanish flock in 1786. We were not allowed on the main grounds of the sheepfold, so we couldn't get into any of the buildings beyond the combined cafe slash gift shop. But as you can imagine, there was plenty to see in the gift shop, with the yarn of the flock available in three different types. The first was a standard, round, commercially spun and dyed yarn, very uniform. I can't remember now if it was a 4-ply or an 8-ply that came with glossy labels and had been processed thoroughly enough. It had no vegetable matter and I'm sure would make lots of knitters happy. But I think you know me well enough now to know that that was the least appealing of the three options for me. What can I say? I don't tend to prefer yarn that looks like it's been polished. Another option was a coarsely spun, bulky, undyed, 100% Rambouillet yarn sold in cakes. And so I grabbed three of those, content to head to the register and, you know, be happy I'd gotten some local yarn from this wonderful national flock. When I turned to see the third display of yarn that was made up of the Rambouillet wool from this flock spun with the fiber from other local fiber farms. And those yarns ranged from lace to DK weight with different amounts of spin to them. And some had been naturally dyed and some were left their natural colors. I just had one of the cakes of the 100% Rambouillet bulky. And instead, I grabbed a hank from this third display that was a blend of the Rambouillet with Shetland and Angora goat. And then I got another two hanks that were Rambouillet, a Shetland gray, and alpaca. All of them are extremely soft, and all of them will be destined for something cozy, no doubt. What that will be, I do not know. There were some signboards around the grounds that we did have access to. They were all in French. It was very clear from what was on offer in the gift shop and all the signage that this was not a location that was marketed to international travelers. It was a site designed for local French people to visit to learn about their national history and heritage. And part of me wonders if this is because, as so often happens, local tourism boards do not understand the interest that people from elsewhere would have in their farming or fiber assets, or whether time has proven that foreign travelers simply don't deviate from the already well-established tourism route that takes most visitors to Paris and a few other sites farther into the country like Versailles and Rouen, Mont-Saint-Michel, but people tend to just stay in Paris. I don't know why, but it was very much a site designed for local people to visit. I would encourage you, though, to add this spot to your itinerary if you are planning to visit Paris, because despite the lack of accommodations for non-French speakers, Google Translate easily made sense of the signs. It's not that much farther if you're headed out on a trip to Versailles to make a visit to the Bergerie Nationale. Just be sure to check which days they're open for general tourism before you go, so you can actually get in and see things, unlike what we were able to do. We did luck out in the end. As we were walking back to our car, we saw a shepherd come out to a paddock with a working dog to do a herding demonstration for some kindergartens. It was our first glimpse of the sheep themselves. We were standing at all kinds of walls and fences, and we just couldn't see any sheep. But they had them out in this paddock that was basically where we had parked. And between the context of what we were watching and the fact that their audience was kindergartners, I found I could understand most of what was said and as we watched. So, you know, 4 years of high school French finally paying off. Absolutely worth a visit. If you have no French, again, just have the Google Translate app ready on your phone. It was unreal to be in a spot where a sheep breed was crafted, and to see the amount of respect that had been given to the process from a time when wool was still one of the dominant fibers of the world. One last song for this episode. This is Dark Space by We 2050.
No.
A few more things before I go. As of this recording, there are still a few Shetland Hogmanay boxes available. 8 of the spring colorway and 7 of the winter colorway. But I did just make a post about them on the Shetland Wool Week Facebook group, and I'm recording this a few weeks early, so I honestly don't know how things will stand when this goes live. If there are any left, you can find those at ithoughtiknewhow.com by clicking on the link to the store. Can you believe we are already at the end of the 7th month of this year? Where has the time gone? December will be here before we know it. Make sure you don't forget to have your mystery yarn box ordered, whether from me or another maker out there. They are such a fun treat-yourself activity for December when we tend to be so busy and pulled in multiple directions. Fiber as self-care. I think we can all appreciate that. I am heading back to Shetland for a very quick visit with my daughter for the Tall Ships event. In fact, fingers crossed everything goes well with this episode release because it will go out as our plane is taking off to head that way. And if something goes wrong, I won't be able to fix it for a good 7 or 8 hours. I'll be home again for a few more weeks before heading back to do the late summer Mackinac Way through Shetland tours. I am looking forward to my last stint as host and getting to meet those of you who will be joining us over those 4 weeks. Jolene will be releasing the dates for next year's tours in October after Shetland Wool Week is done and dusted. If you'd like first chance at those tickets for next year, contact her at info@islandvista.co.uk and ask to be put on the mailing list for the tours. After this episode, there will be 3 more featuring interviews with the Scottish designers involved with issue 3 of the Journal of Scottish Yarns and the accompanying make-along, and then I will be on a hiatus while I'm on the tours and through Wool Week. I'm not sure exactly when I'll come back with the next episode after this one. It might not be until late October. I'm just giving you a heads up. I mentioned before that I'm abandoning the concept of seasons. But I think for the sake of Apple Podcasts, which loves the concept of seasons, I will make this 9-episode run a season. I do have a few folks there in Shetland I'm hoping to talk with, so if I can make that happen, I'll release them as I have them edited. But that is all just a heads up for future events. For now, episodes will keep rolling out weekly, so I'll be back in your ears next week. In the meantime, thank you for listening and knitting with me for a bit. The show notes are where you will find links to any reference materials I used as I prepared the show, as well as links to things I talked about, so be sure to check those out. Find me on my social media accounts as I Thought I Knew How, except on Twitter, which is Thought I Knew How. The groups on various platforms are all called I Thought I Knew How Podcast. Until next time, may you be blessed with stitches that never drop, yarn without joints, and plenty of time to knit.